Yeah, hello, can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great. So, thanks for the introduction. I'm Kai. Maybe there's still someone who doesn't know me. I'm a long-time D user. If you remember the D1 times, there was a library called Tango. I did some work for Tango. The last release at that time from Tango is named after me, so you can still look it up. Well, by chance, I wrote the VibeD book. Maybe you have read it or used VibeD, so I also did some stuff with VibeD. But yeah, mostly I'm well known for my work with LDC, and yeah, that's because I have a passion for compiler construction. Yeah, and I like compiler constructions. LDC uses LLVM, and I wanted to try out some LLVM features just to get more knowledge, maybe to improve LDC. And I needed a test bed, a small compiler. LDC is a big thing. If you change something, you broke something. You can't really use it for experiments. So I thought a bit, and then, okay, I write my own compiler. For a small language, what is a small language? Look around, I found Modular 2 is a cool language. It's very old, but it's a system programming language. It has a small kernel, it's easy to implement, hopefully. So that was one decision. I think, okay, I do it with C++. I use LLVM, so that's not good for a dtalk, but hey, let's do it, less dependencies. Yeah, and one, let's say, rainy Sunday, I sat down, let's write the parser for it. And I started writing the first rule. I wrote the second rule, and I don't want to do this. That's boring stuff. It's repetitive, it's errors prone. I don't want to do this by hand. Why not use a tool? Okay, so I'm a programmer and I like to do the interesting stuff, not the boring stuff. So a tool, no problem, just use D, spit out some templates and very good. I sat down, what should my tool do and what should it not? So just have a scope for me. Yeah, my scope is I want to generate the body of a parser from a description in extended Backus-Naur form. I'll show later an example how it looks like. I want to put decode everywhere, if possible. Well, a cool feature would be if some error correction feature is integrated. And I also like to have this work stand alone or with CTFE, so that I can just have a file on produce a file on disk or just do it use it at compile time. And I also had clear non-goals. I don't want to generate Alexa. Alexa is also boring stuff, but that's really you can write it really fast. And I also wanted to not have big runtime dependencies. Just generate the stuff, mix it in, and you're done. Okay. So I also had a mental model how it should operate. So we have some content, in this case the Modular 2 source, but the source of any programming language as a file or as a string, whatever. There's Alexa who does the tokenizing of this file. It just produces a range. We heard in the talk before the positive things of a range, and Alexa is just it's an input range. You can ask it, give me the next token. Well, there's also a preprocessor because in the normal compilation process, yeah, you have the language, but you also have some stuff with is more like a meta kind or so. So for example, in C, you have the C processor. You have somewhere you have to put the macros. In D, you have the version. You have how to do the conditional compiling. And for example, in some modular 2 dialects, you also have conditional compiling in it. You have to put it somewhere. It's not part of the language. It's a bit different. This goes all in the preprocessor. And so it's basically a filter on the token range produced by the lexer. Yeah, and then we have the parser, which does the syntax analyzing, build up the AST, or do the calculation, whatever you want to do. And my scope is I want this parser, a part of it should be generated, hopefully with at compile time. And I have to define an interface for it. So I want it to be flexible, so I just started with just use some conventions, and if it turns out to be useful, then stick to it, otherwise change it. So this is all still under development. I'm currently using my own tool to write my tool. So the old eat your own dog food principle, I'm learning with it. So that's the current state. But I want to change it. It's not good, it's too much, it's too complicated. But what I have, well, hopla. What's going on? My machine? Yeah, it's cool. Yeah, I'm back. Yeah.
Yeah, you got black. I mean, it was just black, and it's something to do with your machine. And you don't have black slides in there, right? It's all.
I have no black slides. It's all white.
Okay. Well, then please continue.
It was funny right now because I pressed on the button and it went black. So let's see. It's magic. What do I have? I need a token. That comes from the lexer, can be any struct. I don't care what is in, except for one part. I want to have a member called kind, which is just tell me what kind of token is it. Otherwise, put all your stuff into it, what you need, maybe the position in the text file, some annotation, whatever you do, I don't care. The main thing is I need type. This must be an enumeration, and that's all. And I have three functions, advanced, expect, and consume. These are basically functions which moves on the token stream. And the reason they are want to have these functions is because these are the places where error messages are generated, and I don't want to deal with error messages. Because one of the problems I had in the past is you use a big tool, it comes with everything, and in everything means also things like how to read files, how to output error messages, and you use this tool, and suddenly you are forced to use all this stuff because you just imported one tool. And there happens things like I want to translate error messages. I want to have error messages in German, but the tool does not support it. I'm stuck. So I don't want to have this stuff in it. And this was the first approach to just put it out. It's not a good approach. I know it. And I'm reworking it. But that's the current state. Yes. If we look around, a parser generator, that's nothing new. I think it goes back from the 60s or so that people are building up parser generators. If you look in the C++ world, there are a lot of tools. They are covering a big range of approaches. I just listed some of them. In the D world, it's not so much choice, but I learned during the conference that Robert has written one parser, and Rainer has also written a parser generator, so there are more, but they are much more hidden. The most visible one are Peck. So Bastian told about it today, and John also. The other one is AntLR. AntLR is a very good tool, and the people from Funkwerk are doing the dport. So very thanks for it. I used AntLR, for example, with Java, and it's a really cool tool. It would mostly or it does everything I would like to do. With one exception, it comes with a big runtime library and forces me to do some things I don't want to do. Peck has a different approach, so that was no choice for me. How does my input currently look? You have to put this in a file, but the goal is to have it as a string in your D file. It's a standard expression example. So we, what do we have? We have an expression, and that's made up of a term. You can add or subtract another term, and many of them, or also zero of them. What is a term? A term is the same, it's a factor, and you can multiply or divide other factors to it, and the factor itself could be a number or an expression in parentheses. So that's very standard. It's translated. I'm generating a recursive Destin parser, which just means all on the left side is a function. And if it turns up on the right side, this function is called. And the things in the quotes are tokens. So I just expect at this place in the token stream, there must be this token. And there are always some things you can't express with a simple string. So that's normally the part where the lexer come in, so your lexer definition. I don't generate a lexer. I don't have a lexer generator with me. So you have to specify, okay, that's the number. That's also a token which comes from the token stream. So that's basically it. I generate a parser from this description. For the internal data structure, I read this. I create a graph of it. The graph elements are of type node, that's a struct. And during development, it was very useful to just have a visualization of the graph I'm generating. So you have these, if you use the tool, you have the dash D for debug. To spit out the graph in GraphViz format, so you can visualize it. And this graph here, which does not really fit the screen, is the output for the sample expression grammar from the page before. So it's already a lot of things going on there. I successfully applied the Mordor principle to my main data structure, which means one struct to rule them all. It resulted from the fact I tried to build up a class hierarchy to put all this stuff into it. But it turned out that the elements do not have much in common. What they have in common is they are all part of the graph, but that's it. And this technical thing is not a good way to do inheritance. So there is no class hierarchy. And in the end, I put all in one node. And there's the node type, which says, I'm a sequence. I'm the right-hand side. I'm a variable. That's all. it turned out to be very efficient because I always can do a final switch on this type. And if I had to add a new type or remove a type, I always get a compile error with it. And before that, I tried the class hierarchy. And with the class hierarchy, in the standard library, a thing called cast switch, where you can just do the switch on the dynamic type of the object. Works pretty well, but it does not give the compilation error in case you remove something or you forget something. So with this, I say it doesn't really look nice from the beginning, but you really have advantages with it. And you also see the graph is made of several pointers I have. For the right-hand side, every element must be linked, so I have a next pointer. But for the calculation, I must also be a level up. So where I am called, that's a back pointer, and some other pointers. And so therefore, with four pointers, you get a lot of directions, and therefore this big graph. Okay. I did some research for the parser generators, and if you just throw in parser generator also, you get to Stack Overflow questions, and what you find there is people asking, I need a tool to just generate a parser, and the answer is, there are lots of tools, don't do it, they are slow, you get a lot of trouble, and so on. And say, okay, maybe. Then you look around. Clang has a handwritten parser. DMD has a handwritten parser. Is there something true with it that tools are bad for this part? And so one thing which always turns up is generated parsers are slow. Well, if you use something like Bison, which generates a huge table which is interpreted, could be that it's slow. What I'm doing is just generating decode, and that's compiled, and I try to not do things twice. That's pretty fast. So let's see. I'm using my own dog food. I generated an Oberon 2 parser, which really can pass an Oberon 2 module, and I'm using this grammar here for my examples. So they have a statement, and the statement is, well, it's much more, but it's an if expression, then comes a keyword, then comes again a statement sequence, and in the end there's an end. And that's translated to, well, if I see keyword if, then next token from the token stream, I pass the expression, then I consume the then comes the statement sequence, and in the end, I consume the end, and that's it. So I touch every token one time, and then I know where I am, and throw it away, take the next one, go on. I'm not aware that I can do this much faster by hand. That's the code I would write by hand, and therefore it can't be slow. The other one is, if you use a generator, it's not flexible enough. Well, it also comes from the fact if you use tools like Yak or Bison, you can't insert code everywhere. But I have a very restricted grammar. I talk more about that in a bit later. I can insert code everywhere. So I have a rule which says, okay, I have a non-terminal, then comes an equal sign as a token, and then comes the right-hand side, and at the end comes a dot. That's a rule as described from my input syntax for my tool. And I have to do something with it. I have to build up an abstract syntax tree. So, I need some decode to just store my result. And when I call these functions, I just give this as a parameter. It's an out parameter in this case. And if I call the next function, I give it some member as a parameter, and also I have some more code to do it, and all this is nicely integrated. So basically, with my syntax grammar, I have a kind of macro language, a specialized language just to create decode. That's very good, it's very flexible, I can do everything. I can, if I have a special meet, I just show my decode in it, bang, fertig. That's it. Yeah, what else? That's a bit controversial. Often, you hear parser generators generate bad error messages. Okay, I wrote the Oberon parser as example, and well, the Lexa can output some errors because you also can make errors at the lexing level. So for here, there's a hex constant, but the hex constant must have a trailing H. Otherwise, the Lexa say, oh, something's weird. So that's a hand-generated error message for me. It's a bit verbose, but you understand what's going on. On the other hand, I downloaded some source code from the internet, put it into my parser, and the parser said error. And I just downloaded that from the internet. It says error, and it said at this line, well, I expected a semicolon, but I found a colon. What's going on there? It's I was confused. I'm not an expert. I really downloaded it and expected to just work with it, and it produced this error message. And the problem here is the file I downloaded has really a syntax error in it. It's very cool. It was just a copy of Wikipedia, and there was a syntax error in it. And what's missing here is that is a function. All these programming languages created by Niklas Wirth, they make a distinction between a procedure or a function. A procedure has no return value. It maps to a void function in D. And a function returns a value. And if you have a function, but they have no, that's the point, they all start with the procedure keyword. I think that was different in Pascal, which has the function keyword, but later languages all have procedure, but a procedure which returns a value, that's a function, and a function must have parentheses, and they are missing here. The error message would be better to say, okay, there are parentheses missing. But that's really very hard to generate, and I also thought, could I do it better as a human? And even this is very hard, because these are all tokens, and you get up to this point, and in the grammar, you can say, okay, there can now be parentheses or not. So there's an optional part in it. And if the parser is here in this state, it just sees there are no parentheses, so it decides that's no function, it must be a procedure, and goes on, and therefore it generates this error message. So I could fix this by hand if I insert at this point some code which says, give me the token which comes next, and then reason about it. But you can do it. But my question is, how many times do you really do it? You have to sit down, you have to analyze what are typical errors the user make, and then bring this code into it. And that's a tiresome process, and well, I do not believe that many people who write parsers by hand do it for every case and analyze the situation. So that's error message, it's consistent, it's generated, it's okay for me. If I really have the need to fix it to a better error messages, I just can insert code and that's it. Okay, so I now have shown what is the input language. I hopefully made clear that my generated code is fast. So, hey, let's write a decompiler with it, right? Yeah. What I'm going to generate is a so-called recursive descent parser. Yeah, I said I generate a function, and in the right-hand side, I go through the right-hand side. If there's an occurrence of a symbol, I call the function, and I always have one token look ahead. And that basically defines the theoretical class of languages I can parse. So I look at the, it's called the LL1 class. So I read my input from left to right, so in the file up down. That's the first L. The second L means I always look at the left, I look at the left-hand side first. So do I have a... If I have a rule, so here I have a decal sequence rule, and there are some other variables in it. So these symbols are also left-hand sides, and I look from the left to the right, and the leftmost one is called first. So I don't look to the right. I also read my rule from the left to the right. That's the second L. So for this second L, there's another class which does it the other way, later to this. The one means I just have one token look ahead. Yeah, and the very cool thing is that's a very nice grammar class. Just throw it into Google and you will find out most programming languages do not fall into this grammar class. So what have I gained? So it's important to understand what are the limitations to work around them. And the limitations are called LL1 conflicts. And it's just came from the part I have a state, I have a look ahead, and then I have to decide what to do. That's also the main difference to PEC, because PEC just tries out every alternative. That's not the case here. So that's really the main difference between. I'm very deterministic. I have a state, I look at the next input, and then I have to do my choice. If I can't do this, I have a conflict. And typically it can be, so here I have a decal sequence, and the original Oberon 2 grammar says, okay, it can be a procedure or a forward declaration. And a procedure declaration starts with the keyword procedure, and the forward declaration starts also with the keyword procedure, but it has here this optional sign in it. Yeah, and if I know in this state and my next token is procedure, I simply don't know, do I have to call this one because it's a procedure declaration, or do I have to call to this one because it's a forward declaration? So that's a typical example that a look ahead of one does not fit. A look ahead of two would help me here. Another source for conflicts is left recursion. So Bastian also told us today about it. It's very typical. If you go to Google and just find a grammar, for example, for C, they are always in YEC or Bison format, and they have a lot of left recursion in it. And it's you have a statement list, and left recursions mean, well, the first element of the right-hand side is statement list. So it should be just a list of statements, but it's defined this way. So we have a statement, the statement list is a statement list, then comes a statement, or as alternative, nothing. That's the terminating in the recursion. And a statement is something which ends with a colon. Yeah, and if I just translate it, what happens? I generate a function parse statement list, and it sees some look-ahead tokens, and the first thing is I call parse statement list. I have no token consumed, so I have an endless recursion. Bang. What to do? You can try to rewrite your grammar. That works in some cases very good. For example, with the statement list, I know that's a list. It should be just a sequence of statements. And I can reformulate it this way. I have a statement with zero or many statements in it. You can also do this with the procedure example from the slide before. Problem with this is, in some cases, the result is not really good. You lose meaning to it. You don't understand your grammar then. That's very bad. And there's also cases you just can't do it. So that's very interesting. You can't just rewrite your grammar. Because of the, there are two main causes. The first one is the language class with one token look ahead. You cannot solve everything. There are grammars which need two or more token look ahead, and you can't rewrite it to use just one token. It does not work. So that's a result from computer science theory. And other things is we call this class context-free grammars, but that's no programming language is context-free. And maybe you have to do some, let's say, symbol table lookup. And therefore, what's going on to work around this problem, I have the possibility to just insert the so-called resolvers. Resolver is simply a Boolean expression which is inserted in the place where I detect a conflict. And this Boolean expressions helps to decide what to do. So syntax is I have the percent if, and then comes the expression in it. And example from the Oberon 2 grammar, a qualified identifier, that's a identifier, an optional identifier followed by a dot, and then a identifier. So it's like a module import in D. And but there's a conflict because we have the identifier, which is optional, and here also the identifier. So if I if my state is at this point and I see an identifier as the next token, then I don't know if it's this one or this one, because I no chance. So to get around, I insert my resolver, which asks, is this identifier a module? And I keep track of all imported modules, so I just can ask, is the value in my symbol table of modules? Yes, then it's a module, then it's this case. Otherwise, it's just a simple identifier, and it must be this one. So with this, I can resolve a lot of problems going on. My original idea was write a modular 2 compiler, and modular 2 has the same is a language family like C, C++, D. It's also a language family, and often you have one compiler which can compile different variants of the language. So, for example, the C++ compiler can also or is also used to compile C, and in fact, Clang uses the same parser for C, C++, and Objective C. can I do something similar with a generated parser? So that's what I wanted to do with Modular 2. We have at least... with Modular 2, we have the programming in Modular 2, fourth edition version. That's the latest edition from Niklas Wirth. And we also have the standardized version, the ISO one. And there are slight differences in it. And can I use the parser generator to just differentiate based on some flag? Yeah. The first one is, well, we generate from the Lexer a token stream, and there comes the preprocessor in place. The Lexer doesn't care about keywords. It just sees an identifier. And if or generic or module, is if it's an identifier or a keyword, it doesn't matter to the Lexer. It just spits it out as an identifier. Then the preprocessor can be used to just filter this out. The preprocessor knows I'm compiling C++ or I'm compiling C. So in the C case, it knows class is just an identifier. In the C++ case, it knows I'm a keyword. So if I just have a filter on it which decides which is a keyword, which is not a keyword, I can go on and I have a lot of trouble already pushed out. So clear, the parser just looks at the token kind, not at the text or the string value. And if it doesn't see the class token, then it never falls into, or it never tries to parse a class. Yeah, next problem is that's already very good, but it doesn't help everywhere. So you can think of cases where you just add another option which is just separated by a comma, for example, or there's no special keyword at all. But it's only valid in one variant of the language. So what my idea is, I just add something I called a variant selector, which should be only a Boolean in a property in D, and just stick it with a bang to the element which should be valid only in one case. So again, from Modular 2, it has a module system, by the way, so and it's from the 80s, so compare this to C++, 40 years later. So we have a definition where the interface is, and yeah, it starts with a definition, but they also defined a generic option to it, but it's only an optional language version. So I want to have this as a variant. And that would be my syntax in this case. That would be already be handled by the token trick from the slide before, but it could also be done this way. Okay, and that's what I'm currently working on. And here comes the theory into play, and it shows that good idea, but it has some side effects, because what I'm basically doing here is designing a language. And language design is hard. And I just thought it looks very good, a bang and a Boolean property behind it, and I'm done. Yeah. What happens is I introduce, therefore, some things which are optional in one case and non-optional in another case. And if I just use my algorithms to analyze it, then I create rules which are not reachable. So I have some kind of waste in my grammar, and the algorithms are not really working well with this. So I could handle this, just have a filter on the graph and say everything what it's not needed, I do not see it. So that's still handleable. But I can also make some elements optional, and this not intentionally. So again, I write definition module. It can be the normal thing with the definition first. It can also be the generic one. And this alternative, I say it's generic. That's okay. But if you now think we are compiling the standard case, the not generic one, then this is invisible. It's not there. And then I have a definition module can be the normal definition or as alternative nothing. I have made this one optional and that's not good. So it's sounded like a very nice idea and I started to program it just to find out it requires much more thought to implement. So that's something I'm really working on still. Another idea I had is, hey, this look ahead from one, that's very arbitrary. Why do not use a look ahead of two? Because then some other things which require a look ahead of two are solved. I don't need to write a LL1 conflict resolver by myself. And yeah, it can be done. Arndt LR does this, but it requires some more tricky algorithms behind it. And that's one of the things I'm doing this stuff because the algorithms are very interesting. You do interesting stuff and not the boring stuff. Yeah, and still the language class is very limited. So another idea I have is let's create a tool for another class, which is called LR1. I have most of the things already in place with my tool, so I can start it very fast. But the normal execution model is to just have a table which is interpreted. That is nothing I like to have. And there are some more or less theoretical results that that it is possible to output this parser again as code. And what's behind it, that's a big push-down automaton. And the states of this automaton are emitted as code. And the drawback is it gets a huge code file. And there are some ways to reduce this. And there comes the fun into it. You can, on this big code, it is very regularly structured. You can do some data flow analysis to just shrink it. Or there's another technique which is called extended left corner parsing, which tries to find out where are breaks in the grammar. And at that breaks, you can switch to the LL1 code generation. And that's all also a way to shrink it. I find this very, very interesting. That's and there are also not too many implementations of it. So I like to do some more work with this. So you see, I'm really intrigued by all this parser generation stuff. Yeah. That's it mostly. So I have not released anything as an official dub package, but all the current state is on GitHub. You can just clone it and use dub and try it out. I have made no version because I'm still developing it, and as soon as I have a version, it's bad to break things, and I like to try out more. But go there, clone it. If you find something difficult with it, create an issue, write me an email, or contact me on Slack, whatever you like. Especially I like feedback on the syntax because I now have a mix of YAC syntax and from COCO. And that turns out not to be good. And I also like to change this a bit. So whatever your meaning about this, you know how to contact me. Yeah, so thank you.
Okay, question time. Let's see some hands.
Yeah,
Doesn't have to be your own. Put someone else's hand up.
Several years back, I had a similar project idea, and I was working on an LALR parser, and I had it written out, and I was playing around with various grammars, notably for like wiki formats. The biggest problem I ran into was that all the conflicts in the grammars and how they're processed, writing the grammar became extremely difficult for anything beyond the most trivial of cases. And I quickly discovered that it was harder to make a good grammar than it was to just write a recursive descent parser. Like, have you run into similar problems?
Yes. So I'm writing a tool, you'll just need a test case. And I used Oberon 2 as the example here, because that's a very easy test case. It has a very, the grammar is almost LL1, but that's not a real use case. So I'm currently working on C. There's a YAC grammar for C, and it's horrible with a lot of left recursions and so. And it's not easy to say just I put this regular expressions on the right-hand side and I'm done. That's it not. It's you really have to think about how the grammar must look, and it's a very, very hard process. And yeah, that's true. Writing a good grammar is not easy. And yeah, I encountered this too. What you can done also with an LR tool is just having these conflict resolvers in place. So that's always a last resource, resort, and this can be done with LL1 and LR1 compilers or parser generators.
All right, any other questions? Oh, it's a bunch of crickets in here. I guess we're done, Kai. Thank you again.
Yep. Thanks.